Hi everybody, it's Big Dave here from Big Dave's Chess Coaching. I have a video for you that will look over the game of Paul Morphy versus Charles Le Carpentier. Now, first of all, who was this guy, Paul Morphy? Well, there's a picture there for you in the bottom left, a little portrait of Paul Morphy himself. And a brief description, he was a great chess player who was active during the 19th century. And he's considered to be one of the greatest players of his era. Even the great Bobby Fischer is known to have said that he may have been the most accurate player who ever lived. So that's some great regard coming from Fischer himself there. Now, in this game, Paul Morphy is playing against his uncle, Charles Le Carpentier. And he would have been around the ages of between 11 and 12 at this point in 1849. And already he's an excellent player. He was a child prodigy. He's already going to show us his vast skill above his opponent. And he's willing to, in this game, as we can see, spot his uncle a rook. So he's giving up a rook in the corner there on a1, as you can notice. It's totally missing. And that's just to try and balance out the game a little bit, you know, try and make it a little bit fair. But as we're going to find out, that missing rook is pretty much irrelevant to the result of the game. So without further ado, let's dive in and see what happened, why is this so special, and get our first taste for some of the play of Paul Morphy. So in the game we had e4, e5, standard opening, knight f3 from Morphy, so he's attacking the pawn on e5, knight c6, and then d4, so Morphy going straight for the center and allowing this pawn to be captured. Now, rather than continuing by, you know, taking with the knight, which might be a standard way you could recapture the pawn, Morphy decides to play bishop c4. So he's more interested in developing his pieces into the game, getting his army activated instead of grabbing pawns in the center. Black continues with bishop to b4 check, and Morphy can calmly now play pawn to c3, blocking the check, attacking the bishop. And when we have captures, Morphy again, rather than recapturing, continues developing. He castles his king. So he's just interested in getting everything finished in development as quickly as possible, and then he can begin his attacking play. And that's really, really important that we learn from this great master. Now we have pawn takes, so black continues gobbling those pawns. And he does go ahead, of course, in the material. Morphy recaptures, and now we see these bishops. They're lined up here, pointing towards the black king side. So if black is to castle in the future, those bishops are well primed and well pointed towards the black king. So what does black have in compensation? Well, black has the two pawns, of course, that he's gobbled up. But as we're going to see, this greediness, this just grabbing pawns, is going to end in quite the disaster for the black side. So black continues with this peculiar move, bishop back to f8, just trying to defend this pawn over here on g7 from white's bishop. But this in turn completely undevelops the black piece, one of the few black pieces that had been developed. And it doesn't work out too well, putting your pieces back on their starting rank, believe it or not. You want to have them out in the game, active and fighting, as we have already in Paul Morphy's side here for white. He has all these pieces developed almost, and he has his king castled, so this is how to do it. He continues now with the move e5, I believe, further stopping black's development. So now the knight cannot come to f6, and black is pinned down. He has nothing out really in the game. He tries to move d6, so he tries to open up his light square bishop. He tries to have a pawn, you know, be influence that pawn in the center, maybe try to capture it. But the issue here is you don't want to open up the position, you know, have pawns disappear in the middle of the game when you're not developed, especially when you're not castled. And the reason being, once that file, the e-file, opens up, white's rook is primed to jump onto it, whereas black does not have that such a capacity to do that, and his king is stuck in the middle of the board, so he's going to suffer if things start opening up. So Morphy, preparing that idea, puts his rook onto e1. Now it's a brilliantly placed piece, it's developed. Black grabs yet another pawn, and again, as I said, this grabbing pawn strategy we're going to learn is not going to work out well. He's now up three pawns, so that's the plus side for Black. The downside is that White has everything ready to attack, and Black's king is totally vulnerable sitting in the middle of the board. Morphy grabs the pawn with the knight. We have the queen capturing the queen. Now, if you were just playing standardly, you might say, I'll just recapture that queen with the rook, and I'm still well developed. But Morphy is calculating some more aggressive ideas. He's not so interested in taking a black queen and getting the fair trade. He wants more bang for his buck, so he's going after the black king. He plays the move bishop takes f7, check. So there's no time for black to do anything but move his king. And once the black king moves to e7, Morphy continues with check. Knight check, a fantastic move. Now this is a double check. So you can see that when the knight moved here from e5, it wasn't only delivering a check from the knight, it's also a check from the white rook on e1. And when you deliver a double check, when two pieces check the opponent's king, the king always has to move. So that's a very important thing to remember. If you can deliver a double check to your opponent, the only thing they can do is move their king. There is no way they can do anything else. So what does Black do? Black's going to move the king and says, well, why not? I'll grab a bishop at least if I'm going to have to move my king and I'm in this situation. Let me grab a piece for all my troubles. But can you see now, Morphy has actually a mate in one, and he delivers it swiftly with knight taking on h8, checkmate. And that's actually the game. That's the full game. That's checkmate. Believe it or not, already, I believe that's 17 moves, and Black is mated. And what a wonderful performance from the young Morphy, as I said, around age 11 or 12, putting on this show for us. But as we can see, it was all down to the fact that Morphy developed all of his pieces. He developed and got his king castled. He was on active squares, and Black continued just to grab pawns. So Black was greedy, Black tried to get the material, whereas White was focused on development and active pieces. And the result was a stunning checkmate here. The game is nicknamed 8-Ball in the Corner Pocket, which is quite amusing, with the knight there obviously jumping into the corner to deliver the mate. But what a great game, and there are many, many more to come as well at this from Morphy. If you enjoy this, I'll make some more videos on Paul Morphy's games. And I guess I'll see you in the next one. Okay, goodbye.